Welcome to a new edition of the Neon Jazz Interview Series with jazz violinist Sam Bardfeld. He's originally from the New York area, and he's on the heels of his latest 2017 album, The Great Enthusiasms. He realized his dream of becoming a part of the great jazz collective, the Jazz Passengers, and is a frequent collaborator with Bruce Springsteen, a veteran of three recordings and two tours. Over the years, he's worked with a long list of jazz, pop, folk, and experimental acts like Elvis Costello, John Zorn, Anthony Braxton, Debbie Harry, and many others. So please get to know this interesting cat and dig this interview, my friends.
Thank you for taking a minute out for me today. I appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure.
So right up front, I just want to say the jazz violin to me is it's up there with the vibes for me. It's one of my favorite instruments, so I'm going to kind of go into this with a little bit of a bias, just so you know up front.
You have good taste.
Yes, I hope so. So let me begin here with your latest album, The Great Enthusiasms. Talk to me about this album now that it's out and how you feel about it.
Well, it's something I'm proud of and excited about, frankly, if I'm allowed to be earnest in this day and age. It's been 12 years since my last CD. I love the side play. I love playing with Chris and Mike. Mike is an old friend who's on my first record. And Chris is a former neighbor, and we just started playing and hanging, and yeah, that's something I'm excited about.
So let me go back to the beginning of your life here. Where were you born and raised?
Upper West Side of New York.
Talk to me about your exposure to jazz early on. Not only did you get involved with jazz, but how did the violin become your instrument of choice?
Well, that's a funny story, funny the whole thing. When I was five, I wanted to play an instrument, and first thing I wanted to play was the drums, because I was born in 68, and I grew up right near Lincoln Center. And so we went to see, maybe it was the 10th anniversary of Lincoln Center, and it was a big thing of Keith Moon playing. I said, I won't do that, but my parents wouldn't let me do that. So we went to Colonial Williamsburg when I was four, and I went nuts. I became obsessed with American history. And right at that time, the movie 1776 came out. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but
yeah.
Blythe Danner, Gwyneth Paltrow's mother, plays Thomas Jefferson's wife. And she was a fabulous actress and really, really beautiful. And she sings this song about how Thomas Jefferson wooed her by playing the violin, called He Plays the Violin. And I thought, at the age of five, I thought, if I can get Blythe Danner or some equivalent beautiful, intelligent woman by playing the violin, I think that's my thing.
That's awesome. So you went on to study technique with Gerald Biel, improvisation with George Garzon and others. What did you learn from these individuals that had so much mileage on their odometer as you kind of got into that educational learning realm in your life?
Right. Well, that was actually much later. I don't want to bore you with too much education stuff. So I went to Manus Prep, their Saturday program, playing classical music, and then I dropped out when I was 14. Because it wasn't fun to me anymore. I was very competitive, and I really just wanted to play with my friends and jam. And so I started playing, learning to improvise and playing, first studying, learning kind of blues and some kind of fiddle stuff, and then gradually learned how to play jazz. And then in college, I went to Wesleyan and studied with Bill Barron, Kenny Barron's older brother. And so he was kind of my first serious jazz teacher. And I don't know if you know Bill's playing at all, but he was from Philadelphia and a contemporary of Train. And he and Jimmy Heath used to get together and practice together. Bill was kind of fascinated with intervals and was really into Bartok and Stravinsky and Slaninsky, you know, the famous theoretician. And so I got kind of interested in intervallic playing through Bill. I then went through a period of my life where I didn't think I was going to be a musician. I thought I was going to be an academic, and one of the reasons I went to Wesleyan was to study ethnomusicology. So I thought I was going to get a doctorate and be a professor in ethnomusicology. I went through a small period where I thought I was going to be a lawyer, and then I thought I was going to be a shrink. And it wasn't until I was 26, which was kind of old, that I decided to play, that I was going to play professionally, or at least try. And at that point, I kind of dove in and very quickly had my own band because I had been writing my own music. And my first band had Reed Anderson from the Bad Plus in it. And then later, Drew Grass and Mike Serene and Kenny Wessel, who were the people on my first record. So I just kind of dove in. And there was more work in the 90s, so I did a lot of different things. I started playing a lot of Afro-Cuban music, which I eventually wrote a book on. I had a band that played Cajun and Zydeco music, and I did lots of jazz stuff. So it wasn't until my later 20s that I started, went back, and, you know, I was playing professionally, so I really needed to work on my technique. So Jerry was a student of Heifetz, and he actually was sort of a, Jerry Beal, it was a freelance classical teacher, but ended up teaching a lot of jazz people. I was, got his name through Mark Feldman, who studied with him, and Jerry was sort of a mentor to Mark. And I turned Jerry on to Regina Carter and Jenny Schein, or maybe Jenny and I started studying with him at the same time. But for a while, he taught, like most of the jazz players in New York, classical technique. And I also, in my late 20s, I studied with George Garzon, who, you know, is a famous pedagogue, a wonderful guy. I mean, it's worth the price of admission, price of a lesson just to talk to George. I don't know if you've ever sat and had a conversation with George.
Oh, yeah. He's wonderful.
Just to listen to him tell stories. And but George was a great teacher. And then I also studied with Richie Byra, who was also a great teacher. You know, just there's so many great musicians in New York. So there's, you know, I learned a lot of different things from different people playing.
Absolutely. Well, and then you went on. So I guess I want to just kind of ask you, at the age of 26, getting in, you have a little bit more wisdom and mileage on your collective music radar. Was that beneficial for you to wait that long? Did you feel more secure about what you were doing and your decision and going forth?
It's a good question. There are pros and cons, I think. You know, I think there are times where I wish I'd had a more normal conservatory education, because there's a lot to be said for that. On the other hand, I think at that point I knew that I was playing music because I thought I had to. I mean, that I knew what my motivation was for sure, and that was strong. I also think that, you know, when I listen to music, the most important thing that I want to hear is I want to hear someone with a voice, with a personal voice, tell a story. That's something you don't get in music school. And ideally people have both, all the training and and people eventually learn how to become an artist. But when I hear somebody, a soloist, and the main story they're telling when they solo is, I went to music school, that's not a very interesting story. So, you know, I guess all of that is to say that I became myself by being me, and I wouldn't have done that without taking the path that I did.
So what about the Jazz Passengers? What's that experience like to be with them?
Well, the Jazz Passengers were one of my favorite bands when I was in college. So that was in college from 86 to 90, and I guess they started playing in 87. And so, and I'm a New Yorker, so when I was at home, I used to go see them at the Knitting Factory. And so they were heroes of mine. The way that they sort of blended a humor and a sort of, for lack of a better word, their kind of postmodern zeitgeist at the time, and intelligence with great playing was something I was kind of fascinated by, and I was just a big fan. So when I started playing with the band in 2002, it was just a thrill, you know, because they had been heroes of mine.
Well, and speaking of heroes and big bands, you've spent some time with Bruce Springsteen's band as well.
Mm-hmm.
That had to be an incredible learning experience just in itself.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, ironically or not, you know, Bruce wasn't someone who I had listened to a lot of before I started playing with him, but he certainly became a hero and a mentor from working with him. It was just, you know, I kind of fell into, and it was wonderful. I mean, I can't say enough about working with Bruce, the way that he approaches playing live, his commitment to performance, the way that he approaches every gig, really like a jazz musician, in the sense that he's so committed to wanting everyone in the building to have a transcendent experience. And he can play in front of 50,000 people and it feels like it's, you know, the Vanguard or some small intimate room because of this sort of incredible ability to reach everybody. It's a sort of psychological miracle he pulls off. And also, as a band leader, you know, he was just really, we were 17, 18 pieces, and he was extraordinarily, and he's obviously a perfectionist, but he was extraordinarily loose within that perfectionism and extraordinarily trusting. He would bring a tune in. Once we got through the basic, you know, stuff we were supposed to learn, he would play, you know, one or two new things a night, which is, you know, he's known for that. And he would bring a song into soundcheck, and we would kind of self-arrange. He was extraordinarily, and this is an 18-piece band, he was extraordinarily trusting of his sidemen. You know, his attitude was he had the people he wanted, and he trusted them to do the right thing, which is, you know, a lesson in leadership. The other thing was he was really interested in who everyone was as a person and sort of as a character and musically. So, I mean, just A, because he's a humane guy and just was interested, but also in terms of bringing that out as part of the performance. The sousaphone player, Art Barron, the lovely, lovely guy, but, you know, well, I shouldn't say but, I should say and, has a large personality. And so Bruce kind of figured Art out in like 5 minutes and ended up making that part of the show, where at the end of every main set, you know, before the encore set, we would sort of parade off New Orleans style, and then Art would walk to the front of the stage with the sousaphone, and it was just Art and the drummer playing. We'd all left the stage, and then Bruce would come out and drag Art off vaudeville style, is to say, kind of, you know, shut up already. And it was so perfect for, you know, who Art was, and just sort of to make theater the whole thing. And then, you know, because he's just so kind of crazy committed to performance, and Bruce then started thinking of doing that in a different way each night. So we play Madison Square Garden. Art's mother was in her mid-80s, was there. So without telling Art, Bruce had Art's mother walk up to the front of the stage behind him, so Art, you know, couldn't see her, and tap him on the shoulder. And Art turned around and said, "Oh, Mom, holy shit!" You know. And then in Europe, Bruce had the Tex ship a whole second sousaphone. Now, sousaphones are huge to Europe. Just so on one night, just on one performance, Clark Gayton, who's playing trombone but also plays sousaphone and tuba, could walk up behind Art and kind of shadow what he was playing, so Art would think it was. The sound system was kind of screwing up, like there was some weird reverb or bug in the system. But Art couldn't turn around, so then tapped him on the shoulder, and, you know. So, but it was different every night. So it's just, to me, just it's sort of an incredible leadership and kind of commitment to performance. I mean, beyond the songs and the singing and all of that, that was kind of deep, I thought.
You know, last week you two came to town and brought in the Joshua Tree revival, and I, you know, I didn't get to see it, but I talked to people afterwards, and they just talked about how amazing it was. And I always think, you know, U2 is one of those bands that always brings it, but it reminded me of a guy years ago. I ran a youth program in the inner city to YMCA, and he was a fellow at the front desk, and he stopped me one time. We used to always talk music, and he just stopped me, and he said, "Listen, have you ever seen Bruce Springsteen live?" And I was like, "It's on my list. I have to see it." He said, "Oh, my God." I thought he had seen an angel over my shoulder. I mean, he went on and on. And I have never, ever talked to anybody that has seen Bruce Springsteen, whether they were a true diehard fan or someone that admired music, that didn't do anything but absolutely be floored by the entire experience. Like, it was religious to them to see him live.
Yeah, it's kind of it's a unique thing, I think.
Yeah, so I have to do that the next time he comes through town. And he does have a history here in Kansas City, so that has to happen.
Yeah.
Without a doubt.
I recommend it.
So let me ask you this. You've spent your life working, you know, jazz, obviously, but, you know, pop, folk, experimental. You've been on soundtracks. Is this kind of an aim for you in your life, or do things just kind of happen? You see opportunities, you go for it. What's kind of your raison d'etre as a musician and genre-wise? What do you do?
Well, I think jazz is my whole base, and the music that is on the record is the stuff that's my own music, writing my own music and playing that is the thing that's most important to me. You know, I have two kids. I'm not in a position to be a starving artist. Few people are these days. And so I do a lot of different things. But beyond that, you know, I think I'm interested in a lot of the things I do. I have genuine interest in. And I think that it creates more depth to my own music and to art music and to understanding things. For one thing, I have a background in ethnomusicology, so I'm sort of always interested in all these little subcultures and micro worlds out there, whether it's, you know, the Latin scene or, you know, I play with Vince Giordano's Nighthawks, playing music from the 20s, the bat scene or the downtown scene or bebop or, you know, whatever it is, I'm interested both in the music and in the subculture. And being in New York has always been, I just dove in and was sort of like, we'll see, you know, and I had to pay the rent. And I've always just kind of been, had a kind of, let's go, let me, you know, see if I can learn something from this situation. And New York is a sort of an incredible environment to do that, because if you're playing Latin music outside of Cuba, New York has been historically the center of that. So, you know, what an opportunity to play with some of the greatest musicians in the world in that. Or, you know, Vince Giordano's band playing music in the 20s, that's probably the best band in the world that does that music. You know, all the incredible jazz musicians playing. So it's really I just look at it as an opportunity. And, you know, if something gets old and I stop learning from it, you know, I do less of it. But I've just kind of tried to be open, and I think that I've benefited from that.
Vince has actually been on the show a few times, and he came through town with this movie, and I've always really wanted to see him live. Is that just a powerful show to see all of those guys together with him orchestrating it?
Well, it's a great band. You know, Vince always has great players. And he's a real scholar of that music. And so for people who don't know, you know, Vince specializes in music that goes up to kind of 1932, 1933. And that was, it's an 11-piece band. And that was an era that was, you know, including early Ellington, Fletcher Henderson, a lot of the bands that Dick Spiderbeck played with, the Paul Whiteman Orchestra, so many others. But it's an interesting period because it's before big band stuff became codified. So people are orchestrators and people are kind of all over the map. You know, you have people with sort of classical PhD skills in orchestrating who are doing this sort of incredible stuff. And there's a lot of kind of wacky stuff. And, you know, the greatness of Fletcher Henderson and Ellington. But it's before big band music became a kind of pop music and things became kind of codified. And so just to sit in the middle of that, you know, you always kind of hear things better and more acutely if you're in the band. You're on, you know, you have to be on. And so that's been a great education. And I think it's great. It's interesting music. It's fascinating music because it's kind of all over the place. It's the roots of what we do now. I mean, I'm interested in the continuum of jazz and or whatever you want to call it, of American vernacular improvised music. That interests me, and the sweep of it. You know, one of my favorite records is, not to digress, but Sonny Meets Hawk, because, you know that record?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, you know, that record is Sonny Rollins with Coleman Hawkins and Paul Blais on piano. It's like the history of music right there, because you have Coleman Hawkins with his still the kind of 20s, early 30s vibrato, you know, that, and he's pushing himself. And Sonny Rollins is playing, I think that record is 62, 63. So he's kind of playing free, but not free the way anybody else played. Sonny Rollins is playing free in his very focused motivic way of playing. It almost sounds like you're listening to like Tony Malaby or somebody from now, the way they play free. To me, that's like 100 years of jazz in that CD.
Yeah.
And the Paul Blais is, you know, the solo he took on All the Things You Are, king. You know, people call that the shot heard around the world. So I'm kind of interested in the continuum of the whole thing. And I think to get back to my CD, to me it was all, it's kind of very much a Weird America CD. And I'm interested in that, in American vernacular music and putting myself into that.
Well, speaking of that, speaking of education and all these experiences, as an instructor at the new school, what are you trying to give your kids? What's your philosophy as a teacher?
Just a couple of things. One, to try to encourage them to develop a voice and to become an intellectual about what they do and to be an artist no matter what level they're at. I think that there are specific ways that you can work on that without, you know, very specific ways that you can work on that without just kind of, you know, spouting gibberish. I also really believe in the standards tradition. To me, playing free and playing in standards tradition is the same thing. Learning how to play good melodies and create good melodies. And so if I'm teaching a student, you know, being solid on just simple things like voice leading and the harmonic rhythm through a piece, you know, where the chords lead one by one. So the basics of that, you know, developing melodies, developing motifs, I guess that's, one could say that's kind of different from the scalar approach that's really prevalent. I mean, that's important. It's important to, but I hear a lot, when I hear something, I don't want to hear people running scales. You know, I want to hear melodies and melodies, whether they're melodies through changes or melodies that we have in and out of changes or melodies that apply changes or melodies with no changes, you know, or melodies that are created out of sounds and textures, you know, whatever that is.
So let me ask you this about your performing career up to this point in your life. You know, you started at 26, you've been at it for some time now. How do you feel about your career? What's happened, the breaks you've gotten, everything up to this point?
Well, that's a big question. Well, I try to balance things. I mean, I'm very grateful for some of the work that I have. I'm grateful to have a continuing association with Bruce Springsteen, because that's an ongoing relationship. And I'm grateful to be in the Jazz Passengers. And I've also to work with Roy Nathanson on his side project. And I guess now that my kids are a certain age, this recording is a little bit of a, it seems like a milestone to me. I haven't put out a record in 12 years, so it seems important. I'm interested in collaborating with more people and putting myself out there a little bit more. I don't know. Is that an answer to the question?
It does. It absolutely does. Yeah. So I want to ask you this, too. Coming from New York, being a part of a lot of live shows and seeing live shows, I want to get a little fantastical here and put a DeLorean in front of your house and ask you if you could punch in the coordinates. Where are you going to go? Who are you going to see live?
That's hard to answer. There's so many great things, and I have so few nights out between. it's hard to answer that question. I mean, there's so many players I love. I went the other night to see Mark Dresser at the Stone with a 7-piece band, and that was really great. I'm sorry, I met Craig Tayborn, who was at the Stone the week earlier. Craig is a hero of mine. Ben Goldberg's another friend I've been doing sessions with and getting to know, as he spends a little bit more time on the East Coast, and he's doing another residency at the Stone. So I've been enjoying playing with Ben. There's so many great players. It's hard to, I always love seeing Chris Davis when she plays. There's so much great music all the time. It's hard to answer that question.
That's the answer right there. Let me ask you a generic question. Why do you love jazz?
You know, to go back to your question about the whole my life story and, you know, not having started playing till I was 26, I felt like at that point, I thought, well, if I can do this, I mean, jazz is the greatest thing in the world. If I can do this, you know, how can I not try? How can I not attempt it? You know, it's just, I think that there's something, the combination of things, the combination of the cultural, historical circumstances that gave way, you know, the African diaspora, and the incredible sophistication of African music that came to America and mixed with other things, with, you know, with Western harmony and the American song tradition, and the history of that throughout the 20th century, the richness of that, the, all the incredible heroes that came before us. So there's the specifics of the social, cultural stuff, and the, you know, the greatness of that music, and then the which I think is one of the great musics of all time. And, you know, out of historical circumstance, the conjoining of that stuff. And then, of course, mixed with, well, music from Cuba, that's, you know, comes from Africa. But, and then the ability to be an artist within that and sort of be a sophisticated, you know, cosmopolitan person in 2017 and put your, put, say something personal, within and make an artistic statement within that. How could you not want to do that? I mean, what an incredible opportunity and to do that. And then more than that, you know, you're not a painter, so music is a social thing. And it's something you create with other people, and then to have, be able to have that kind of dialogue and to sit with, play with Chris and Mike. You know, I felt like I gave an inadequate answer to your question in the beginning because it was sort of everything at once, but to be able to sit and play with Chris and Mike and improvise with those guys, who are some of the greatest people in the world at what they do, and to develop a shared language and then have them interpret my kind of weird idiosyncratic pieces and lend their voices to that and create something together with that. I mean, what a beautiful, incredible thing to do that. What a, so, at, you know, it seems to me like, you know, in this day and age, to have a family and make a living and raise kids in New York, it, it's not easy to try to balance all of that. And like I said, you know, it took me 12 years to get around to making music that I felt I'm good enough about and sort of my own playing to bring that up to a level I felt good enough to, where I felt confident about putting something new out there in this climate where, you know, nobody buys records anymore. But to be able to do that is just an unbelievable thing. It's a beautiful thing. And to try to, like I said, to try to balance art and family and all of that, it's not easy, but it's, you know, that we're only here on the planet once. To be able to play with Bruce and the Passengers and Anthony Braxton and be able to do my own music along with Chris Davis and Mike Doreen and, you know, that's a, I feel grateful for all of that.
Wonderful. So I'm going to piggyback off of that and ask you this. This is my final question. Everyone has everyone has a perception of you, your family, your friends, your fans. But when you wake up and you face today, who do you think you are?
Oh, boy. We're going into shrinkland now. I don't know. You know, there's a, the famous quote about Pablo Casals being 96 and practicing, and somebody asked him, of course I'm going to butcher the quote now, but somebody said, well, Pablo, you're, you know, you're considered one of the greatest cellists of all time. You know, why do you still practice, or why do you still play scales? And, you know, that he said, I think I'm finally getting better, or something like that, you know. You know, I think the more, the better you get, to realize, the more you realize how much better you could be, the more you, the humbler it makes you. I think the more perspective you have. So I, it's, you know, it's very hard to tell how other people, and I think as a musician, as an artist, you can't get too bogged down in that. I think you try to get better. You try to work on your own music. You try to push yourself forward. You try to stay fresh. And you try to, you know, interact with your peers and grow as an artist. And of course, you know, we live in a universe where there are, there's an objective reality, and you put records out and people react to them. But like I said, I'm proud of this record and I hope other people like it. And I think it's, I think I have a unique place in the jazz violin world in terms of, I'm kind of a inside outside guy somewhere in between the straight headers, like, you know, Zach Brock and the free players like Matt Mineri. So the record, my playing is sort of overlaps the worlds of straight ahead and free, and also kind of downtown jazz or that downtown New York world. And so I think I have a unique sound and voice in the world of jazz violin. I'm conscious of my voice and developing that as an artist and trying to maintain that and develop it. And yeah, so I'm, you know, I'm trying to get better and be with my family and make a living and make good art.
I think you're doing that. I appreciate it, Sam. Thank you for taking some time out today to talk with me, open up with my audience, and for the music. I appreciate it.
Thanks so much, Joe.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to yet another Neon Jazz interview, where we give you a bit of insight into the finest players in New York, Kansas City, and spots all over the world giving fans all that jazz. And thanks to Sam for his cool and his music. If you want to hear more interviews, go to Famous Interviews with Joe Domino on the iTunes Store. Visit NeonJazz at YouTube.com. And for everything Neon Jazz, go to the NeonJazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, enjoy the music, my friends.
Neon Jazz.